Hi everybody, it's Adam from Lucid Pixel, and today I want to talk with you about when shit gets real, okay? And what I mean by that is, as an artist, if being a passionate artist is what really matters to you the most, being a professional, being a fantasy illustrator, being an illustrator for trading cards or for video games or films or whatever it is you want to work on, okay? Or for books. If being an artist is what really matters to you most, then there's a very good chance that you will, or already have, depending on how long you've done this, hit times in your life where you get an incredibly heavy and real emotional kick in the nuts, okay? Or in the ovaries, you know, for lack of a better term, okay? You get a real heavy emotional hit, blow. Okay? And what I mean by a heavy emotional blow, I'm not just talking about a little bit of artist's block where, you know, where you don't know what to draw, you're staring at a blank page, you don't know what to do with yourself, you know, and you spend a couple of hours and you get frustrated. That's not what I'm talking about, because that kind of stuff happens every day. I'm talking about the times in your life where you get depressed, where you might get depressed, or you might get incredibly discouraged about your career, you question yourself about your career, and you have an incredible amount of real emotional pressure. The type of real emotional pressure that you should take seriously, okay? I've experienced this in my career, and when I reflect back on my career, I remember I've referred to this many times because it was one of those times in my career where it really, it's like Ed Hooks, the acting for animation teacher, says an adrenaline moment in your life, okay? When Ed Hooks refers to it when something really scary or something incredibly happy, something very emotionally intense happens in your life, it burns, that adrenaline burns it into your brain and you can remember it vividly for the rest of your life, right? Like a near death experience or something like that. Well, adrenaline can, that type of adrenaline moment can also happen in a negative way where you go through such a hard time with your artwork that it can emotionally drain you, it can emotionally depress you, it can put you into a state of anxiety to the point where it can, or almost can, completely hinder your ability to move forward with your artwork. I've experienced this, and I remember, like, as I was going to say before, I remember there was a point in my career where I wanted to succeed as an artist, but I at the time I was more interested in being an animator, a cartoon animator, because that's what I grew up drawing. I wanted to learn, I wanted to be a professional animator. I went to school for it and all this kind of stuff. And I did go to school and I studied classical animation and I studied fine arts and I found myself out in the industry and couldn't find work for the fucking life of me, okay? Nothing. And when I say I sent out hundreds of CVs, I'm talking literally hundreds of them. Okay, every day I was sending out 5-6 CVs to different people, and the only people, if anybody, that called me back were people that wanted me to do these shitty little personal jobs. Can you do a drawing of my basset hound for me? Type of shit, okay? The stuff that made me go, dude, I didn't spend 6 years in fucking school to draw your dog, you know? And although I was nice to them, in my head, I was ready to yell at them for asking. I was so frustrated, okay? And as such, I blamed my skills artistically. I don't have what it takes. I'm not the right type of person for it. I pursued the wrong career, and whatever the case might be. And I blamed my competence as an artist. I blamed my abilities as an artist. I blamed my personality. Whatever I did, I was internalizing it. I was pointing all the fingers at myself, because who else am I going to blame? You know, am I going to blame Manchester United for the fact that I can't draw? No. Okay. But I did. And the emotional struggles that I dealt with were very emotional. You know, I got angry. I got sad. I got frustrated. I got overwhelmed. I got exhausted. Okay. But some, for whatever reason, okay, this is the side of yourself as an artist that can't be explained. For some stupid, stubborn, idiotic reason, I didn't stop. I just kept doing it, okay? I know why now. I didn't know why then, okay? I didn't have that confirmation in my head yet, okay? Because I went through so much, I went through this so often, and I dealt with unemployment, I dealt with being broke, I dealt with having to be supported by my mother, or being supported by, you know, my partner in life, or whatever the case might be, and that really attacked my ego. That made me feel incompetent, you know? my partner has been, you know, in a stable career for the stable job for the last 10 years, and I still feel like I'm a fucking 2-year-old kid who's doing his little drawings, okay? And I really felt that way, okay? You know, I'm broke and all of this, and I have to be supported by other people. And a whole reason, I was raised to be a professional. I was raised by a professional woman, okay? I was raised by somebody who was, you know, very good with her finances. At least that the time I knew her, you know, that I was alive, I saw her as being somebody who was very stable financially and very responsible financially. And I just felt like I was a failure, okay? And I was really hard on myself for that. And I realized at a certain point in my career, there was a turning point in my career. And I'll describe that turning point in my career. What happened in my brain? What took me from point A to point B? Okay. At the time, I was sending out CVs. And when you're struggling emotionally, you reach out to people. I was reaching out to my mother. I was reaching out to my friends. I was reaching out to my significant other to, you know, just to have somebody to talk to, somebody who could help me through it. Of course, it's limited. People are limited in what they can offer, and what they offer is their own advice, right? It's what would work for them. It's not necessarily what's going to work for you. But I was grabbing at whatever I could because I was feeling desperate at the time. And what was happening was I was getting advice, lots of different advice from different people. One person was saying, you need to do this. Another person was saying, you need to do that. Another person was saying, you need to learn 3D. So I said, you know what? I look in the newspaper, all I see is looking for 3D artists. Okay? Nobody's looking for a 2D artist. So bite the bullet, Adam. Yes, I know you've just been through 6 years of school. Yes, I know you've been drawing your whole life, but you know what? Time for a reality check. Time to learn 3D. So I did, but I didn't have money to go back to school. The clock was ticking on whether or not my electricity was going to get cut off, right? I was scrambling to get through and buy groceries. I was scrambling to pay the bills, right? So I was in a very desperate headspace. So I said, I cannot dick around with drawing for the rest of my life. I have to learn 3D. So I did. And I picked up a book on 3D, and I'm working and I'm working and I'm working, and I'm going through page by page by page, learning every different facet of the 3D pipeline on my own. Okay? That's tough because, well, luckily there was a very good book that was very, you know, a very well-written book, which I recommend if you ever want to learn 3D. They probably done updated versions. It's a Beginner's Guide to Maya Animation by Dariush Derakhshani. Look up that book. Excellent book. I learned 3D because of Dariush Derakhshani. Okay? So that being said, I knew that at the time I was on unemployment insurance, okay? And at that time I thought, okay, my unemployment insurance runs out in 8 months. So now's the moment of truth. Learn 3D now. And you only have 6 months to do it because you're going to need 2 months to apply for jobs and find some work. But do it. So I did. And I learned about, I had to start from complete scratch. I had to learn what an edge was. I had to learn what a vertice is. Okay? I had to learn all of those things. And to add insult to injury, I didn't know at the time, but this book started by teaching NURBS first. And I know by saying that there's a lot of 3D guys out there that are going, oh God, Adam, you did what? You did NURBS? I learned NURBS, which is basically like Bezier curves, okay? The most hair-tugging, you know, hair-tearing method to model anything, especially back in the time, okay? And I got, you know, you get a third, a half of the way through the book, and then it says, and now let's introduce you to polygons, right? And I went, oh my God, I can't believe I wasted all this time learning NURBS. And that was 2 months of my time, you know? So okay, now I don't have 8 months. Now I don't have 6 months to get this done. Now I have 4 months. Okay, so that timeline is tightening up on me. Okay, so learn how to, you know, learning about polygons. Okay, how do I make a sphere? How do I make a cube? How do I make, you know, how do I make a cylinder? Okay, how do I deform it? How do I extrude? How do I, you know, bevel? How do I do all of these different things? Okay, blah, blah, blah. And I decided to make a project where I was going to model a human because I knew that modeling humans was probably one of the most challenging things to do. So I did a model of my daughter. I still have it to this day. I did a model of my daughter who at the time was around 4 or 5 years old. So I modeled her. But the first model I did was in NURBS. Okay. The second one I did is in Polygon, so I had to start over from scratch, which of course was a hell of a lot easier using polygons, but still, okay, I'm learning from scratch, so it was a very, very slow, time-consuming process. And I'm modeling, okay? I've got the model. I actually did the model. Awesome. Okay, then I had to learn how to texture. Then I had to learn how to rig. Oh, God, rigging. Fucking rigging. Oh, my God. Fucking... Fucking rig, excuse my French, but fucking rigging, okay? Learning rigging from how to build a rig from scratch, you know, how to get it to articulate the way you want it to, how to have a rig that has the versatility to be able to move your model the way you want it to move, right? So I learned rigging, this whole technical, very, very technical aspect of rigging. Okay, then now I have to learn about skinning, and they didn't have paint skinning. You couldn't paint weights at the time. Everything you had to do, everything by hand. So I had to learn how to skin. That took me another fucking forever. And then I had to learn how to, once I had the skinning and the rigging and everything and all that kind of stuff, then I had to learn how to animate. Animating was a piece of cake. Animating is easy for anybody, okay? So I learned how to animate, and I was already an animator, so fuck, I already knew how to animate. Awesome. So I'm starting to feel really good, right? And, now the timeline, now we've reached the point where I've got about 2 months left, not even 2 months left. I've got about a month left, okay? I've got 3 months left until my UI runs out. And I animate this character, and I'm liking it. It looks great. Okay, now I've animated. Now I have to learn how to boat. Now I have to learn about lighting. Now I have to learn about rendering, okay? And that's a big learning curve, too. There's a lot to know about that kind of stuff as well. And then I decided just to up the ante a little bit. I learned a little bit about cloth simulation and stuff like that, right? Because I wanted her to wear a certain type of clothes that kind of hung loose, because I didn't like these polygon clothing, you know, which I shouldn't have worried about at the time, but I did. But that was an extra week out of my time to learn how to do that. It wasn't too difficult in Maya, okay? And I did everything, and I animate everything, and blah 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 blah, and I'm just about to render my project. I'm almost ready. I'm just doing the last finishing tweaks on my animation. And at a certain point, because I was working on such a shitty computer with, like, I don't know, like 0.5 gigs of RAM, you know, like no RAM on my computer. It was an old shit box, you know, because I never used it for 3D. I only used it for painting and or for drawing. I didn't even really paint at that point. It was more just for doing line drawing. And I hit a part of the model because I was just worrying about facial animation at that point. I was just learning how to do morphing and stuff like that in the face to do facial animation. So I hid the body. I did the facial animation, but didn't realize that even if something's hidden, all of the vertices are still active. And I never backed up my work because I was a freaking moron, okay? I do all the facial animation, and I'm moving, and I'm selecting vertices, and I'm doing all kinds of crap, and I save my work, and then I unhide, and my entire model has been blown out of the water. Weak! Polygons all over the place, and frickin', like, I destroyed my model, okay? And me being the idiot I was, didn't do incremental saves. I just flattened my last file, okay? I know all of you listening to this right now are going, oh, God, Adam, you didn't, you know? Yes, I did. I've only got 2 weeks left on my mental deadline, because I know that my UI is going to be running out soon. And I've just destroyed all my work, okay? And the emotional pressure of realizing that was so heavy, it threw me into a little temporary depression, okay? Because it was like trying to climb up Mount Everest. If you've ever watched a mountain climbing documentary, they're pretty intense, you know, frostbite and storms and landslides and, you know, cliff sides that crumble at any time. And, you know, people die from climbing Mount Everest all the time. You know, it's a very common occurrence. It's really literally a challenge that people take where they are risking life and death. Okay. And you get frostbite, and you got nothing but, you know, two fingers that aren't frostbitten, but your legs are gone, your hands are gone, and you're climbing up with two fingers trying to get up to the top of the mountain, and you're almost there. And then some albatross comes and picks you up and drops you back down at the bottom of the mountain. Okay? What the fuck are you going to do, you know? And it put me into this state of heavy, heavy, heavy emotional anxiety and depression. You know, not long-term depression, but short-term depression and heavy depression too. I was very, very depressed. I felt, what was I telling myself at that time? What was going on in my head when I said that? When this happened to me, it was, give up. You've spent your whole life thinking you were going to be something, and you're not. You failed. You know, you're one of those stories of people who almost made it, you know? But like they say, like Seinfeld says, you know, nobody ever celebrates the silver medalist, you know? They're a fucking Olympic silver medalist, you know? But it's like, I almost made it, you know? I felt my life was, I almost made it, but now I'm a nobody, okay? I fucked up my career. I fucked up my life. I chased after the wrong thing. I'm never going to be good enough. And I cried. I got angry. You know, I got frustrated. I was irritable. I alienated my friends for a full week. Okay. I didn't even go near my computer. I didn't even want to see my computer because my desktop background was the model that I had destroyed, essentially. Okay. And I didn't even want to see it. I didn't respond to emails. I was just completely in the shits, okay? Why did I feel that way? Let's take a step back, because this is what I ended up having to do. I ended up doing a lot of writing to get myself through that, okay? And I've done a lot of writing since, every time I've had ups and downs in my career and stuff like that. If we think about it, be it 3D modeling, be it digital painting, okay? This is digital painting. It's this plus this equals picture, okay? That's what it is. Why am I getting so fucking bent out of shape? Why am I sitting there saying I'm incompetent? I'm a loser. I'm no good. I made a mistake. I'm an almost could have but should have but didn't. Okay, that I'm that. I, why am I telling? Why am I saying this about myself? Why am I being so fucking hard on myself for not being able to get something when all it is drawing? Okay. Well, there's two reasons. One of the reasons why I'm being so hard on myself is because I'm taking for granted the fact that this is my passion. This is my identity, okay, as a human being. My identity is an artist, okay? Or at least so I believed. I still do believe to a certain degree, but not the same way I did back then. The second is because what's pressuring me isn't the art. The pressure is the deadline. Okay? I got incredibly emotionally down on myself for not succeeding because I was not succeeding in the time that I gave myself to succeed. If I look back at that time in my life, I did end up getting that model done. Okay? I didn't sleep for almost a week, okay? And I busted my balls and my UI did run out, and about 4 days after my UI ran out, I still had about 150 bucks in the bank that I was milking for all it was worth, okay? And I sent out my portfolio and I got a job as an animator. And it was funny, I ate up the last 20 bucks in my account, and 2 days later I got my first paycheck. It was that close, okay? But why was I so hard on myself? Why was I beating myself up as an individual because I couldn't succeed? Was it because I wasn't good enough? No, it was because I wasn't good enough fast enough. Okay? That's why I was beating myself up about it. Had there not been any pressure, had I been perfectly financially stable and everything was perfectly fine, and I didn't have anything to worry about in terms of finances, had my UI, you know, or had I had a paycheck coming in that I knew was going to be there for the next 2, 3 years, I'd take my sweet ass time. I wouldn't stress out over anything. And I wouldn't be coming down hard on myself and my own competence as a result of it. What was making me feel that way was not the fact that I wasn't good enough. It was the fact that the external forces around me were putting extra pressure on me to be productive. Now, if I actually look back, I learned to model and skin and rig and texture and animate and light and render in 6 months on my own. That's quite an accomplishment when I look back. Adam, good job. But that's not how I felt at the time. I felt like a complete fucking ass. Okay? When you feel that way, when you find yourself feeling this an emotional pressure that transcends art, okay, that goes beyond art in and of itself, chances are it's not the art that's pressuring you. It's not your abilities as an artist. You're perfectly fucking capable, okay? You are more than capable. You are brilliantly capable. But the external forces around you are, you're basically mixing up the external forces of your life, the inevitable reality of your life, with the reality of your skill, and you're putting them together in the same package. So when it comes time to point blame at somebody if something doesn't succeed, you don't distinguish one from the other. And what I'm telling you is, you need to. Look at it this way. Think of another job that's incredibly high pressure. Okay? Individual pressure. Think about being a doctor. Why do people get into medicine in the first place? Why do people decide to be surgeons? Why do people decide to get into the medical profession? Their love of people. Their want to help people. Okay? Yes, some people get into it for money, of course. Some people get into art for money too. Okay? But they do it because they have a compassion for people. They cannot stand the thought of seeing people suffer without being able to do something about it. Okay? They've put themselves in the position of wanting to help other people get better. When they see people suffer, they have to help them. Okay? That's the real underlying purpose why people become doctors. Why do people become police officers? Because they might, for whatever personal reasons, they are sick and tired of the injustice that people face on a day-to-day level, the unfairness, they can't stand bullies, they can't stand, you know, spouses that beat up their significant other, you know, domestic violence, they can't stand seeing yet another 12-year-old child die of a crack overdose. They can't stand seeing that anymore, and they want to be a part of the solution. Okay? And that's why they get into that profession. But as we know, there's two sides of that. There's the professional side, dealing with the problem, and there's the personal, emotional side. And as a professional, police officers and doctors, just as two simple examples of it, because there's many other examples, are yin-yanging between the emotional and the personal side of themselves. Sometimes those emotions get the better of them. Think about, you know, cops who lose their shit, you know, a lot of this police brutality thing that goes on, okay? These are cops that have been pushed to the edge to the point where they lose their shit and they forget why they're there in the first place, and they end up becoming the criminals. They end up becoming the abusers, when in fact, probably the reason they got there in the first place was to stop abuse, okay? Cops don't get into police work for money, because we all know that police officers do not make enough money. In fact, they keep getting their fucking salary cut all the time. Okay? There's a real noble cause behind why they get there, but some people just, they choose the wrong path. Their emotions get the better of them, and they end up kicking the crap out of an innocent person. They lose sight of humanity. Doctors. This doctor just had a little kid walk in, this little six-year-old boy, with cute dimples, who just got wheeled into the emergency room because his uncle decided to take him on a motorcycle ride, and the kid went flying off and split his leg in half, and he's screaming in pain. Okay? There's the side of the doctor that's saying, I want to kill this fucking loser uncle. There's another side of him that says, I can't stand seeing this child suffer. It's hurting me in my core. And then there's the other side of him that's saying, I'm the one who's in charge of helping this person. And if I'm sitting there freaking out, screaming and crying in the corner, this kid's not going to get any help. So it's my job to fix it. Okay? It's my job to be cool. So it's his ability to take his emotional side and his professional side and separate them. And say, okay, what's the problem? Don't worry, you're going to be fine. And the kid is screaming and he's bleeding and his bones are sticking out. Okay? Or the cop is sitting there and he's trying to create a sense of, he's trying to maintain the peace, he's trying to neutralize the situation, and there's a man there with a knife to a woman's razor saying, we're gonna fucking kill her, and there's already two dead bodies on the ground, and you know he will. Okay? That guy just wants to start opening fire and fill that guy with 600 bullets, but he's got to keep his shit together, okay? It's separating the emotional side of yourself from the professional side of yourself. Now, if you put that in the context of artwork, you have the professional, you have the emotional side of yourself saying, I have 2 months to get this done, or I have 2 weeks to get this done, or I'm broke, or I just got a notice from the electric company saying they're going to cut off my electricity if I don't pay by tomorrow, okay? And the professional side of yourself saying, I've got art to produce. I've got a professional portfolio I have to produce. Shit just got real, okay? So how do you handle that? How do you deal with that? Well, how does a doctor or a police officer deal with that? They take a moment, they step back, and they think to themselves, yes, this guy is a psychopath, and yes, he's a murderer, and yes, he's going to kill these people. What are the steps I need to take to neutralize this situation? When do I open fire if need be? And when do I not open fire? When do I jump? Am I going to shoot? Am I going to shoot him through her leg? He's trying to think. He's trying to take the logical approach to it. Okay, he's separating himself from his emotional self, and he's just looking at his art as art. Okay, he's looking at his job as a police officer, as a job as a police officer. My job is to fix the situation. If I freak out and lose my shit, we're all gonna die. Okay, and that's just the reality of it. When it comes to your artwork, if you feel like you're suffering emotional pressure that's beyond this, it means you have to step back and address your emotional issues first. Because if you don't address your emotional issues first, you're gonna burn yourself out. Okay? You're gonna blame the wrong thing. You're gonna blame yourself as an individual. You're gonna blame your capacity, the how smart you are, how competent you are, how whether or not you made wise decisions in your life. You made a perfectly good decision in your life. You are perfectly competent. You are perfectly capable of being the artist that you want to be, okay? But you have to address your emotional side first and say, why do I feel this way? And put your canvas aside, put your computer aside, and just sit down with a book, with a pen and a paper, and write down, why do I feel this way? I feel this way because I'm scared. Why? Because I'm broke. Why? Because I lost my job. Why? Okay? And keep digging back further. I lost my job because I suck, because I'm not good enough. Okay, why do I feel like I suck because I'm not good enough? Well, because I tried to complete this job. I tried to do this job, and my boss told me I wasn't good enough, and I got fired. So why do I feel emotionally heavy about that? Why am I hating myself for it? Well, because I'm not good enough. Why aren't you good enough yet? Because I never got the training I needed. Why didn't you get the training? Because the training wasn't available. So how do I get the training I need then? Where start look for a solution. How do I get the training I'm looking for? By going on YouTube and looking up tutorials, by taking a mentorship, by going to school, by blah 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 blah. And you start to look for a solution. You need to be better at art. This is what you need to get better at it. It's a one-on-one situation, okay? It's not complicated. This is what you need. My hands, I can't draw hands yet. I'm lazy when it comes to drawing hands. My hands suck. Okay? Well, take a week and learn how to draw hands. It's that simple. But when you're sitting there, I don't have a week to draw hands. I'm fucking broke. My electricity's gonna get cut off. Okay? You have to deal with the electricity side of things first. You have to deal with that emotionally, and if you can, get some kind of help. Get help from a family. Get help from a family member. Your electricity gets cut off, start looking for an alternative until you can pay your bill to get your electricity put back on. But don't confuse your personal problems with your professional problems. You have to separate those two. You aren't a failure as an artist. In fact, if you think about it, you've probably accomplished a lot more in a very short period of time than most people could because you had the pressure of the world on top of you. Okay?
Sorry about that.
Okay? Because you had the pressure of the world on your shoulders. If being an artist is what you love most, if being an artist is what you love most, you will succeed. I look back, 15, 20 years into my past, I felt that all the time. I was always worrying about money. I was always worrying about whether I was good enough. I was always getting rejected. All of that was happening. Constantly, 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 for years. That's incredibly emotionally difficult for me. But I'm not anymore. But I might, hey, the economy might, you know, go shitty, you know, whatever the case might be, and I might find myself broke again. Fine. I'll go and I'll wait for a little bit so that the money issues don't bother me, so that I can deal with other things, or maybe I'll look for an alternative. Okay? Sorry, there's always somebody guarding in my neighborhood. Okay? And there's another second little thing I want to mention in regards to this. The other thing, hold on one second, let me pause this video so I can close my window. The second part to this is, at that time, I learned 3D, and at the time, I was listening to a lot of different people talking to me at the same time, saying, you need to learn 3D, you need to learn this, you need to learn that, the industry's in this, the industry's in that, you have to follow that, and I found I kept chasing after different jobs. I've mentioned this in other talks before, okay? Every single time I found myself on the unemployment line, every single time I felt like I was, you know, back to square one, it was like that albatross came and dumped me back at the beginning of the, at the base of the mountain again. Every time that happened, I had voices outside of me and inside of me telling me I gotta learn something new. I gotta get better. I have to have a new skill. I learned so many goddamn skills, I don't even know what to do with myself. Okay? I didn't even know what to do with myself. I learned 3D, I learned 2D, I learned After Effects, I learned Premiere, I learned, you know, you name it, just fucking list goes on. Okay, I can't even list them all. I found that every 6 months I was learning some new software. And every time I started over from scratch, I was starting the whole learning curve over again. I was constantly becoming a beginner over and over and over again. But from the age of 5 up until that point, I was a 2D artist. I drew, I painted, okay? That's who I was. But I kept abandoning that side of myself and saying, Adam, you're never going to be good enough at that. You have to learn this instead, okay? So I had to keep starting over and over and over again. And one of the things that made my career focus and the success of my career and the stress level of success plummet by about 85% was when I finally got the nerve. When I was not actually got the nerve, when I was finally pushed to the edge of I can't do this shit anymore. I can't keep reinventing myself over again. And I took a long, hard look at myself and I said, I've taken so many risks for other people. This studio wants me to know how to draw like this. This studio wants me to learn 3D. This studio wants me to model. This studio wants me to render. This studio wants me to this. This person thinks I should blah, blah, blah. Okay? That I said, you know what? I love you all. You are my heart and joy. I love you with all of my heart. Okay? Fuck off. Go fuck yourself. Okay? I love you, but fuck off, okay? This is my life, this is my career, this is my passion, and I cannot make everybody happy. I was put on this planet to do my thing, to make my meaningful contribution to this world. And the most meaningful contribution I can make to this planet is my art, and the type of art that I love. A fantasy artist, okay? And when I made that decision in my life, all of a sudden, the number of things I had to be good at went from this to this, okay? Just one. I just had to be a fantastic fantasy artist. And I put because I did have a lot of energy. I used to think I just don't have the energy to keep up. No, I didn't have the energy to learn 50 things, okay? At least not sustainably. I learned 50 things, but I was burning out and I was young, okay? And I thought, there's no fucking way I can keep working like this for the next 50, 60 years. There's not a chance in hell. I cannot survive. It's not sustainable. And besides, there's no light at the end of the tunnel. It hasn't improved my situation, right? Because I'm not great at it. I'm just good at it. I'm okay, you know? I'm mediocre. And in order to succeed, you need to be great, okay? At something, right? The world of I was passionate. I knew all the artists. I knew all the books. I watched all the movies. I always watched these kinds of documentaries. This was my world. It was my kindred. These were all my kindred spirits. I knew everything. You talk about it. You talk about an interview you saw by such and such an artist. I've watched it 10 times. I know it verbatim. Okay, this is my world. This is what I do every day. And as soon as I said, you know what, I love you guys, but go fuck yourselves. Everybody, go. Stop telling me what to do with my life. This is my life. You stand over there. You can bitch and complain. And it came to some resistance. People saying, you know, Adam, you can't be so selfish. You have to be realistic. You've got bills to pay. And my answer to that was, your solution didn't work. And furthermore, your solution is, it's very easy for you to tell me, go learn 3D, go learn After Effects. Okay, it's very easy for you to tell me to do that, right? It's very easy. Why? Because you can sit on your fat ass and tell me to do what me to do with my life, and it's 6 months of grueling and stress for me to figure it out, to realize I'm no better off. And then when I'm finished when I did the 6 months of 3D, you go, go learn After Effects. Okay? You're toying with my life. And furthermore, I'm toying with my own because I believe that shit myself. So I was putting that own pressure on myself. Of course, I'm not blaming everybody else, right? I'm responsible for my own life. But I learned to have faith in my own beliefs. And you know what? I'm telling you to have faith in yours. If you spent the last 50, 60 years of your life partially pursuing a career, but never quite making it, there's a good chance that you've got the pressure of the world on your shoulders, that you're sitting there thinking to yourself, I'm fucking 60 years old. I still haven't made a name for myself. I'm a loser. You're not a loser. But chances are there were too many things that deviated you away from your path. You've made your life too complicated. You're taking on too many responsibilities. And furthermore, you haven't separated your emotional self from your professional self. And when it's time to draw, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to draw. It's not time to worry about your bills. It's not time to worry about your girlfriend or your boyfriend. It's time to draw. And when you draw, you're gonna be drawing from 7 in the morning till 10 at night. Okay? And if you're a parent, it's from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and then from 8:30 or 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. Okay? That's a lot of time to get a nice portfolio and get a lot of nice work done and learn some good shit and get really damn good at it. Okay? And only focus on that one thing that matters to you most, because nobody ever hires a jack of all trades. They hire a master of one thing, and that's all you need to be good at. So you master that one thing, and the complicated elements of your life that make you feel depressed, that make you feel overwhelmed, okay, are going to narrow, and your focus is going to become razor sharp, as opposed to being peripheral. You don't want to live in your peripheral. You want to live within your area of focus. Okay, that's where you want to focus your career. That's where you're going to get the best results. And as soon as I made that commitment to myself, as soon as I said, this is about me, this is about my passion, this is about where I'm going with my life, okay, I've paid my dues, now it's time for me to do what feels right to me, within 1 year my entire career transformed. 1 year. Okay? There were still financial struggles and stuff like that, and I did have the support of people I care about. The people were there to help me, support me through them, and I'll be eternally grateful for that, as I will be for them, as I am for them, you know, to support them now. But in 1 year, I went from being somebody who sent out hundreds of CVs to being somebody who all of a sudden got 3 emails in a week from different people offering me well-paying jobs that I never even fucking applied for. Okay? Some I applied for, some I didn't. And I'm sitting there going, you know what? I was not an idiot. I was right all along. I just was chasing after the wrong path. I was diversifying my path too much. I wasn't focused. I had to look at myself. I'm the one who lives in this industry. I'm the one who knows what people are looking for. And I knew that I've never seen a job offer asking for somebody who knew how to do 10 different things. Everybody's always looking for something specific. And I also learned that I can't be 10 different types of an artist. I can't be a fantasy illustrator and a sci-fi illustrator and a mech designer and an environment artist and a this and a that and a that and a that and a that. No, I'm this type of artist. Okay? And I focused all of my energy, and all of that energy that I dispersed, I focused into one, channeled into one vent, into one path, and the amount of energy and time that I have to invest in my artwork is tireless. I'll never run out of energy. I'm a fucking marathon runner when it comes to digital painting. But I am one shitty CrossFit trainer, Antonio. one of my students is Antonio. And this guy, he's an exception rule. I think, you know, CrossFit trainers are partially gods, I think. But I'm definitely not, especially not when it comes to my career. So if you find yourself in this heavy emotional headspace, separate yourself, your professional self, from your personal self. Recognize them as two different things. When it comes time to paint, it comes time to paint. Don't put a timeline on how long it takes you for you to learn something. Focus on learning it well, and don't worry about how long it takes. Okay? That's rule number one. And rule number two is stay focused on what it is that you want to do with your career. Don't diversify yourself too much. Don't try to handle too many things, because if you do that, it's all going to come crumbling down. All right? So hopefully this helps. Remember, I have a Q&A as well. Okay? And so if you have any questions, you can leave a comment in this video if you want, or you can go and check out my Q&A videos and leave comments there as well. So I try to do that every week, but it depends on how much time I have and how many questions come in, because I'm not going to do a Q&A based on two questions, whatever the case might be. So hopefully you enjoyed this, and don't forget to hit that subscribe button. All right? Take care, everybody.